casting a vision for us, introduce us to some of the things that were happening and some of the legacy of Black Adventism.
Yeah, first of all, I want to say that it's been a pleasure to tabernacle with you and Light Bearers and all the good people in the chat and watching on social media. We've been together for a month now, and I have grown bald in your service.
So that's a blessing. Good.
Kevin has too. And it looks like Kevin and Doug still have their full heads of hair. So we have remarked that Black Adventists have not had the luxury of not being involved in their communities or so-called politics. Major issues of racism terrorize the places they lived and the people they loved, and they felt duty-bound by their faith to respond. These Blacks preached the gospel and worked to achieve justice for the least of these in their communities. And instead of seeing those two things as contradictory, they saw them as inextricably intertwined. Very quickly, I'll share two cases of Black Adventist civil rights activists that changed this nation and by extension the world. The first is James Chiles, C-H-I-L-E-S, sometimes Childs. James Childs was born into slavery in Virginia in 1860. He attended Lincoln University, that's a Black school now university in Pennsylvania, and he earned a JD from the University of Michigan Law School. At age 30, he moved to Lexington, Kentucky, where he opened a law office and became what many hold was the first Black lawyer in the city. He was also an early Seventh-day Adventist in Louisville, and with his wife, Fanny Bates Childs, his pastor, the inimitable A. Berry. We kind of discovered now that his name is Alfonso. His name was Alfonso, but he's always referred to as A. Berry, and others like Mary Britton. They formed a potent nucleus for the truth. In the local church, Childs did a little bit of everything. He was a deacon, a treasurer, a board member, a pro bono lawyer. One day in 1907, he purchased a first class ticket to Washington, D.C. on the Chesapeake and Ohio Railroad. At one stop, he had to switch trains, and in the next train, he sat in the whites only car. When the conductor insisted that he move to the colored car, Childs refused and a policeman was summoned. Ultimately, Childs complied, although under protest, and he moved to the colored car. But he was upset by the whole event, and so in response, he took legal action against one of the biggest companies of his day. That's the C&O Railroad. So he took them to court, arguing for the racial desegregation of trains. Childs' case went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the Black Adventists became one of the first Blacks to argue a case there. Childs ultimately lost the case, but a strong precedent of protest against unjust laws was set. Fast forward to 1944. Irene Morgan, a Black Adventist woman in her 20s, who had just suffered a miscarriage, boarded a Greyhound bus in Hayes, Virginia, headed to Baltimore, Maryland, which was her home at the time. According to the law, Morgan made her way to the Black section of the bus and took a seat. As the miles blurred by and more people piled in at each stop, the bus became crowded. And at a stop, an incoming white couple boarded the bus and every seat was taken, so they needed seats. A black woman with an infant in her arms was sitting next to Morgan, and she got up for the white woman. And Morgan asked her what she was doing, where she was going, but the black mother was already up and the white woman sat in her seat. And so the white man, the husband, the father of the couple, he looked at Irene Morgan expectantly, like, get up. But Morgan didn't budge. So the bus driver, who was the adjudicator of such dilemmas, he was summoned, and he angrily demanded that Morgan vacate her seat, but she refused. The bus driver began yelling at her, calling her out of her name, while the other passengers urged her to comply, but Morgan refused, taking a stand by staying seated.
I like that.
She had
come on now.
She had paid her fare like everyone else and was in the black section. So the bus driver summoned the local sheriff, who stormed onto the bus with two burly officers. The sheriff demanded that Morgan get up. She refused. He thrust an arrest warrant in her face. She didn't take it, so he dropped it in her lap. And she said, "You don't even know my name." And she picked up the warrant, tore it to pieces, and tossed it out the window. I'm talking about Adventists here. Enraged, the sheriff then made a grave mistake. And Irene Morgan said, "He touched me." He put his hands on me. I kicked him where men should not be kicked. I'm sure some of the people in the chat are going crazy, like, Jesus wouldn't do this. Well, because I'm just telling you what happened, okay? You can theologically make of it what you will. So the sheriff hobbled off the bus, and the deputy was up next. She says that he was trying to put his hands on me to get me off. She said, "I was going to bite him, but he was dirty. So I clawed him instead. I ripped his shirt. We were pulling at each other." The other officer joined the fracas, and he and the other officer finally subdued Irene Morgan, clutching her by the arms, and later there would be bruises. And he told her, he said, "Wait till I get you to jail. I'll beat your head with a stick." So she was carried off the bus, then jailed, and she spent a lonely 7 hours in a dingy county jail cell on the charges of resisting arrest and violating a Virginia public transportation statute. And she was all alone in the world. But throughout the whole ordeal, Irene Morgan said that she never had an ounce of fear, despite the local KKK vowing to kill her. She said that her faith in God sustained her. The judge fined Irene Morgan $100 for resisting arrest and $10 for violating the public transportation segregation law. Morgan informed the judge that she would pay the $100, but not the $10. She declared that before she would pay the $10, she would take her appeal all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States. Now, her case, Morgan v. Virginia, championed by the legendary attorney Thurgood Marshall, was heard by the U.S. Supreme Court, which on June 3, 1946, ruled in favor of Morgan, striking down their Virginia law requiring racial segregation on commercial interstate busing. And in 2001, Morgan was awarded the Presidential Citizens Medal by President Bill Clinton, and the citation read, quote, "When Irene Morgan boarded a bus for Baltimore in the summer of 1944, she took the first step on a journey that would change America forever." So these are—
What? Yeah, this is an Adventist woman, man. This is an Adventist sister.
a lifelong Adventist system. So two Adventists, American citizens, interstate public transportation, both taking a stand, both cases heard by the U.S. Supreme Court. One sets a precedent, the other changes the law of the land, making our country a more just, a more righteous one. And what more shall I more say? For the time would fail me, the time would fail me to tell of Mary Britton, Matthew Strawn, Valerie Omega Justice Vance, Terrence Roberts, Frank Hale, J. Estelle Barnett, Miles Martin, Warren Banfield, Saville Brown, Richard Bland, who through faith subdued the kingdom of racism, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of bigots, quenched the violence, racial terrorists, escaped the edge of prejudice, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in flight, turned to flight the armies who called them aliens, and the other. I'll stop there.
That's wow. Man, oh man. If you don't write a book on that, brother, you should be disfellowshipped by the church. You need to write a book on that. That is amazing. what a beautiful testimony. Go ahead, Kevin.
Two seconds, Ben. People have heard of Rosa Parks. Talk about Irene Morgan and Rosa Parks for 2 seconds so that people know what's going on there. Who's first? What's the difference between them? Because Rosa Parks didn't get up either, right? So what's up with that? Why do we know about Rosa Parks and not Irene Morgan?
Irene Morgan was probably a little bit before her time. She was 10 years before Rosa Parks. And her case resulted in an overturning of a law. But we may say something like the time wasn't quite right. It didn't pick up and ignite like Rosa Parks did. And she didn't have a charismatic minister like Martin Luther King Jr. To champion her cause. So it was a little bit before her time, but we can definitely say that these sorts of things were catalyzers. And the summer of 1944, and later in 1946, when the Freedom Riders rode to test the new law that Irene Morgan, that her case brought about, they actually had a song and had a chant that included Irene Morgan. And that said, she was the one who paved the way. So these Freedom Riders, when these laws were instituted nationwide, the South often didn't abide by them. It's like the good Adventist in the chat room, the speed limit says 65, but you're going 75 to get to church. So the law is there, but you're not abiding by it. So the freedom fighters, like later with the those who sat with the and did the sit-ins in the restaurants, they tested the laws to make sure that they were applied. Mm-hmm. And so it was rough going, because they were hit, they were beat, you know, they were thrown off, they were thrown in jail and abused in jail, but the whole time they were singing songs that included Irene Morgan's name.
Wow, man. Kevin, Ben, that connection between Rosa Parks. Wow. This is history that needs to be resurrected. This is history that needs to be recovered, because I think it really impacts our vision of Adventist identity. Ben, I'm not done hearing you talk yet. Can you bring Sister White?